So what I want to do is I'm going to actually kind of reset for a second here, go over a couple of things that we discovered just kind of talking around here. So one thing that we discovered was you guys don't have this update rate. And again, this is the problem with me being the lead developer on the project. I always have the latest and greatest in various versions and things like that. And we are rapidly updating the system, GNU Radio, constantly. One of the problems, I think one of the main reasons why we're seeing things run so slowly is because when the embedded USERP came out with the OMAP processor, we didn't want this huge, really well fast update rate. So I'm updating here 10 times per second. So we actually dropped that down for the embedded processor, I think like once or twice a second. And that was kind of hard coded. Then there was a version change, which is probably, it looks like it's different than what you guys have, where it's now a variable that you could set from the outside. So I think if I, go down here and say, give my update rate as once per second, now we're just seeing that, right? So it's not a processor thing. It doesn't look like you guys have that in this version. So as I said, we're constantly finding these little things and trying to help out and add them. But so I think it's nothing, and that's what, you can pop open a system monitor, you can look at top to see how much CPU your computer's actually using, and it probably isn't that much, but it was really just the update rate. So this is just taking samples every second and plotting them now. So that's thing one. What I want to do is, again, now that I think everybody's pretty much set up with GNU Radio Companion, let's go back and start from scratch. Just hit Control N, or you can go up to File you can say File New, and it'll pop open a mostly blank canvas. So what you can see here now that we're starting from scratch is just two things. So the options block is the that just kind of controls a lot of the parameters of the program that's generated. So as I said, the two things that are important really are, you can change top lock if you want to save this as a different file name. You set top lock to whatever file name output you want it to be. So we'll say, experiment one. And that's going to create experiment1.py when we actually generate the code. So use the code generator. The other thing is, you're welcome to stick with a WX GUI. It tends to have problems with OpenGL versus non-OpenGL, and it's, like I said, I think it's a pretty ugly system. So I like to go in here and switch to the Qt GUI backend. And that's all we should really need to do at this point to get where we want to go. And then click OK. The second thing that by default shows up in your canvas is a variable for sample rate. So samp underscore rate is a default variable. It defaults to 32K. So, because that kind of starts to control everything and how things are clocked or passed around. So I'm gonna go ahead and just save this right now. And I'm gonna call this as a, that's one. And of course, there really is no need to have the same name, the GRC file, as what we put into that, instead of top lock, I put experiment one. I like to link them together, but there's no reason why you have to. That's completely arbitrary. All right, now we actually wanted to do something. While I've got it open, since it's right there, let's go ahead and just drop in our throttle block right now and look at kind of what he's telling us. So, he's got inputs and outputs, so anything that's passing through him is just going to be throttled by the rate that we specified. And if we double-click on it or open the properties, the important thing there, that sample rate parameter is set to that variable samp underscore rate. So that's the default variable, and that, we kind of know those things are tied together, so this kind of sets itself up for us automatically. The other thing that I didn't really point out, and I was just working with Phil to kind of explain some of this, is the data types. Data types are really important, and they can be a real pain to work with. You have to make sure that your data types match. And so by default, we tend to work off of complex samples. So by default, this guy came up as complex. And the inputs and outputs in this guy are going to be the same. So if it's complex inputs, it's complex outputs. But we could change that to any one of these. if we wanted to. Let's change it to float, just so we actually have the experience to having done this. All right, so we change that to float. We hit OK. And one thing to notice is that instead of having two blue ports, they're now orange. And so that's a clue. That's supposed to help us out with what the data type is. And what's going to matter is that the port that goes into this input port have to have the same colors. So that's going to help us match the data types. We can know, if we go up to help and go to types, that's just a clue as to what all of these different colors are for you. So if you're confused, if you forgot something, you can always pop this open and see. So in our case, this orange is this this float, so 32-bit, so that's our single precision floating point data type. So, and again, what we started with was blue, which is our single precision floating point complex data type. So there we have our float. Now, little pro tip, the up and down arrow keys will cycle through the various types. So that's just a convenience for to be able to go between them. So we started out blue, I hit the down arrow once, and we're now at floats. So then what we'll do is this time I'm going to generate just a sine wave. And so the sine wave comes from the signal source. So I'm just gonna, so under sources, I just look at signal source and you can just drag and drop it out here. And now again, he's blue. So if we try to connect this guy from output to input, that's a little hint to us that arrow is red saying, wait, these blocks don't match in the data type, something's wrong here. And of course it is, because we know our colors don't match. So blue does not go to the orange. And again, I'm just going to use the down arrow key to change that color. And you see, as soon as that color changes, the arrow went from red to black. So now we know that that connection is solid. But we also want to look at this guy's properties. So if we double click on this guy, again, instead of using that down arrow, we could come in here and choose the right output type. But we're at float here. And then we can choose what type of waveform we want. So we can do a sine or a cosine. And in fact, they're actually the same thing. Like, we don't even like offset them at the beginning. They really are just the same thing. You have a question?
Just real quick, the colors in this box, do they mean anything?
They do, actually. They
do. Can you explain that?
I'm not sure I can. No. They're related to, no, this is the thing. This is kind of embarrassing. I just discovered that they meant something just like last week. So this was actually, GNU Radio Companion is great. It was actually written by an undergraduate from Johns Hopkins, who's now one of the lead engineers at Edis Research. So he did this, I'm pretty sure it was a senior design project, was to create GNU Radio Companion. So that's to give him credit, but also to say, I don't go into the guts so much of it, so I am still learning a few things. So what I do know is that, again, this orange color means that this is expecting a number, specifically a floating point number. If you see, I think if it's dark purple, that's a string. So a dark purple can take anything that's a string. And I believe blue specifies that it's a variable name or like an object name. So it's something like that. I don't know if that's actually written down anywhere. And as I was going through this, I was like, oh, wait, that, okay, yeah, no, there's something there. But what I do know is that orange does mean that it's actually expecting a number. And here's, this is designed to try to be clear as far as how you set the parameters. So when you're creating a sine wave, you want to be able to specify the frequency, the amplitude, and the offset, so the DC offset, essentially, of a sine wave. So does that make sense? So you can just, we'll keep it at the default, but you can feel free to set them to anything. You could set this to, frequency to a variable. So we could change that variable with one of our range tricks if we wanted to. Same principles apply that we did with the noise source example. So I think the next thing to do is just we'll drop down one of our Qt GUI syncs. So look for that in the Qt GUI. I think in yours it probably just says Qt GUI widgets. So if you drop down that cluster of blocks. There's a Qt GUI sync here. Pop it out, and again, using a little down arrow trick to convert from expecting complex inputs to expecting floating point inputs. And what you can see here is there's only the two data types. So that that's important if you ever wanted to like drive bytes or bits or something like that into a time sink. Like if you wanted to look at that thing in time, what you would have to do is convert, do a type conversion, and there's a huge number of type converters over here. So if you say we're coming in with integers, you'd want to convert those integers to floats. And of course, this doesn't make sense here, but you can see the fact that there's two different colors on the input and output, that's indicating that we're doing this kind of type conversion. But we don't need that right now. That's just a future thing if you ever come to that situation, just to know that you can do that. So then we connect those two things up. We'll pop open the properties of the GUI sync. And again, there's not a whole lot to be said for this right now. You can see, you know, that there are some things. I'll drop this down to, I think, actually two. That's probably what you guys are working on. So we all look pretty similar. No, I know. That's what I'm saying. I'm trying to make mine. I think it. Yeah. We'll see what happens, because I'm not sure if. Again, this is the inaccuracies of using timing information in a processor. So we'll see if this matches okay. Because when I did my one before, it seemed slower than 1 second. But we'll see. Here you can turn on and off the various, like there's those tabs for the different domains. We'll just keep them all on for now. It doesn't really matter. So at that point, we should be pretty much set to run this and look at our signal source. And so you just hit that execute button. And of course, sine waves are really boring because they don't really do anything. Of course, it's a real sine wave, so you have the positive and negative frequency.
What if you don't have the Qt GUI sync as an option under sync?
Qt GUI widgets. And that's part of this change that's happening in 3.7. And I know this is confusing up here. My environmental variable is set for the wrong. No, I know what I didn't do. There's a config file that I didn't set. In fact, let me do that. Let me do this real fast here. Okay, now this should look more familiar, because again, I'm back to the same situation. I don't have that update rate control either, so I'm now using your version. I forgot to change that config file. So now we should be, and we should see on the side here, where are you? Oh, looks like my screen won't let me get down to it now. There we are. So now I have the Qt GUI widgets there. So now we should all be on the same level playing field and hopefully avoid further confusion, at least with that. So if I go up here, oops, now I wanna. So now if I run this guy, of course. Yeah. So which one am I? I really should have done that, shouldn't I? Yeah. Except then I wouldn't have my presentation. All right, well, I apologize. I'm just, instead of trying to fix that, I'm just going to go back to what was working for me. These are always a moving target, but there we have our, and one thing you can do if you have like a scroll, like a scroll bar or a mouse wheel or something like that, and you use it, you can change the dynamic range of the graph so that we can actually see basically the noise floor of a floating point number. And there's our, so that's not, like I said, that's not too interesting by itself. What I think would be more interesting is, so if we look at our operators, these are just basic mathematical operations. And I'm gonna take an add block here and drop in an adder into the system. I'm gonna convert it to being floats. And then I'm gonna go back up to my sources and pull out my noise source, drop him in here, again, create a float output. And instead of coming from the throttle, so we're gonna add a sine wave to a noise source. So we're gonna put the sine wave into one port and the noise source into another port and the adder into the Qt GUI sync. And so now we should be able to run this and see a little bit more interesting happening. And indeed, we have now a noisy sine wave. And we can look at it in the time domain and see that, yeah, that's a pretty noisy sine wave. Although, you know, you can still see the sine wave, so not too bad. So those are some of the things you can do with, and so this adder here, as I said, it just came out of the operators, and you can adder, subtractors, multipliers. Here's one, add const, so you can actually specify a constant value that's in, that you're gonna add to every sample that comes in if you wanted to, you know, change the level or anything. Another trick that you can, not trick, but another property of the adder block is the number of inputs. So if we actually had five signals, say, that we wanted to add together, we now have five ports if you just change that value in there. Of course, we don't, so. So we'll go back to two. So does everybody get that?
Yeah. Steve?
Yeah. So the throttle, your Gaussian noise source, I guess, is, I'm trying to understand, you know,
the throttle, why the throttle works at all in this case?
Does it need to be on both? Did you put it after the adder?
It doesn't need to be anywhere in particular. The throttle, actually, and this goes into deep guts of how the scheduler works. What the throttle is going to do is it's actually going to kind of back up the scheduler. All the buffers are going to get full, and the scheduler is actually going to be able to only chunk through. Because what's going to happen now is the samples into that adder that are coming out of the throttle block, those are going to be backed up. And so the noise source is going to try to push more samples to it, but the adder says, wait, I'm still waiting for this other port to give me its samples. So now both of them are basically waiting. So everything is nicely clocked together inside of the flow graph. But that it's a subtle point, and it really goes into the depths of the scheduler, but yeah. Is there anything else? Okay, so I apologize where I just kind of threw everybody in there at first, and hopefully walking through this one is kind of caught everybody up to speed with how to work within GNU Radio Companion. And from here, a lot of it's going to be playing around, you know, throwing stuff in, taking stuff out, changing parameters. Those dynamic sliders can be really nice to, because what we could do is we could make a dynamic slider for the noise amplitude so you could see how the noise is affecting the sine wave. Those types of things where you're just kind of experimenting and playing around and getting a feel for, like I said, all of the blocks on the side here. So as I said, GNU Radio, its meat, its core is the scheduler, but we do provide a heck of a lot of blocks to do various things on the side. And knowing what all those are is not easy. And as I said, you know, Eric Blossom started developing this in 2001. I started working on it in 2006, I think, and I've been the maintainer for the past 2 years. I'd say there are still a few tricks inside that I'm still learning myself. So it's a complex world once you get inside of it. Is there anything else I wanted to say about that? I did want to mention another thing. One of the things that we've been rightfully accused of is horrible documentation. And that is absolutely true. And we have been working really hard to correct that. And so that is one of the things in particular that we're working on with this 3.7 move. As I said, we have to touch every single block to convert the structure, the internal style from the old style to the new style. While we're doing that, adding documentation, at least the basic documentation of, you know, the brief, what is this block supposed to do, and what are the input types it expects, those types of things are going to be more exposed in the next couple of months. So I know when you look at the documentation at first, it's going to be frustrating, but we have made a huge amount of improvement, and we're continuing that. That's a kind of a mandate that I put on myself to improve that aspect of the code. Let's see. I guess we'll drop out back into the presentation. Let's see, we don't need to, just to give you guys a better feel for the types of filters that you can create. As I said, so FurDes is one tool that you can use. OptFur is the other one that does the Parks-McClellan algorithm. You can, again, look at the documentation to find out the various ones. As I say here, you can, the various types of filters that you can build by default, high pass, low pass, band reject, and then you can also do Gaussian root race cosines for pulse shaping purposes, and Hilbert filters, so you can do Hilbert transforms. We do have some IIR support, but it's not highly optimized. It's hard to optimize IIRs for general purpose processors where you have you want to pipeline efficiently. FIR filters are great at that. So our FIR filters, even though they're running more taps versus what you can do with an IIR filter, the FIR filter is going to...
one feedback is a pain.
Yeah. So the FIR filter really is where you want to go. But we do support, if you did have an IIR filter that you had a very specific purpose to implement, we do at least support that. Although the generators of the IIR taps are not quite there. I think actually the new GR filter design tool that's coming out, that came out of the Google Summer of Code, that actually uses SciPy's IIR tap designer for us. So you can actually use that tool to design IIR filters, but it actually uses SciPy's code and not ours natively. But then there's other types of filters as well. So probably the most important version of IIR is just implementing a single pole IIR, so you can just easily drop in an averaging block into your code. And then we have adaptive filters. So these are filters where you adaptively change the taps. So these are used to implement, specifically implement our adaptive equalizers. So we support CMA and a decision-directed LMS algorithm right now, and definitely support more in the future. Then this is a nice idea. As I said, so you can create your own Hilbert taps if you wanted to do that, but there is a Hilbert block itself. So Hilbert_FC will convert from a real signal to the analytic signal by passing through a Hilbert transform. And then the N taps, that's the number of taps you want to use. So that's how good of a filter do you need to do your Hilbert transform. And then we have, I have a huge set of polyphase filter bank implementations now in GNU Radio. Really specifically, the channelizer and the synthesizer. So you can actually, you take in a wide bandwidth and you give it the channel, how many channels you want to split that into, and it splits them into equally spaced, equal bandwidth channels. And the synthesizer does the opposite. It takes baseband channels and combines them into one wideband channel with them spaced properly. Decimators and interpolators, those are very similar to the decimator interpolating filter in GNU Radio that was already in GNU Radio. What's nice is you can actually specify which channel, so you can actually kind of do baseband. You can alias a channel up in some frequency down to baseband and just extract him. Some really clever techniques to save a lot of computation. And then an arbitrary resampler. So what's nice about this is you can give it a floating point number as the resampling rate. And so the input rate times this floating point number, this real number, that's the output sample rate. And that really can be an arbitrary number. All right, so this... again, I'm not telling you guys anything new. I alluded to it when I placed, instead of using a FIR filter, so we have a FIR filter, but I also use a thing called the FFT filter. So the FFT filter uses this concept that convolution in time is multiplication in the frequency domain. So the overlap and save properties of doing fast convolution in the filter is something that we really get a huge win out of. This is comparing the two filters. So the blue is the FIR filter. So our FIR filter does time domain convolution. So just the straight up, you take a block of samples and the taps, and you multiply all the samples and taps and add them together, shift over the input samples, do it again, right? Just time domain convolution. The red is showing what happens when we do this overlap and save in the frequency domain, so the FFT, the fast convolution. And the overhead of doing the FFT and the IFFT is painful at first, but not that much painful. You can see down there, that crossover point where those two guys kind of cross there, and this is the amount of time it takes to compute 1 billion samples on some random processor that I had when I generated this graph, all right? So we want to stay low as possible. We want this to be as efficient as possible. So the crossover point for when the FFT filter dominates in speed over the FIR filter is somewhere around 20 taps. So it's a pretty small filter that you need to actually make better use out of just doing time domain convolution before using FFTWs, FFT, and IFFT actually become more efficient. And you can see that guy is creeping up very, very slowly. I mean, it should be n log n or plus or minus reality, but somewhere around there. So that's one, again, trick to know is that we have both versions of the filters in GNU Radio, but if you're using anything with any significant number of taps, the FFT is probably where you want to operate. Here's some more information to know about tools available in the filter design package. So we have all sorts of windows, and I was yelled at enough that I finally put in the uppercase Harris as an alias to the lowercase Harris. I thought it was clever. Nobody else really did. If you know Fred Harris, he always writes his name with lowercase.
So. Legally changed in court.
Yeah.
Why? Really?
Yes.
Because he's Fred Harris. He's ask him about it. He gets a little glint in his eye when you ask him about it. All right. So again, in our filter FIRDES, these are the various ones you can call. That _2 version of all of the standard ones over here, that allows you to specify the out-of-band attenuation. It's just another parameter that you can adjust. So we went over this already, but here it is just explicitly explaining what the low-pass 2, the parameters to the low-pass 2 filter are. And you can specify the gain sampling rate, end of the pass band, transition width, attenuation, and then you can also specify, although those are, like I said, they default to those guys, and you can specify the beta if you're using a Kaiser window. Okay. So we try to make things as flexible as possible when you're using this stuff. And I just realized there's a typo there. But here's the same thing, only we're looking at the complex band path, so that you can specify the low cutoff frequency, the high cutoff frequency, so you're specifying the two edges of your pass bands. And then the transition width, this is symmetric. So the transition width from the start and stop of on either side of that passband is going to be symmetric, unless you're around zero. The optFIR, as I said, this is implementing the Parks-McClellan. Here are the possible ones. We don't do the pulse shaping filters with this. Doesn't really make sense, actually, the way that those are designed. But you can do the standard ones here. We should probably, because I don't think it's easy to, we should expose the Parks-McClellan algorithm like straight at, so you could actually put in various starts and stops. I mean, the Parks-McClellan, the Ramez algorithm are pretty powerful, and you can manipulate them in a lot of ways to make more than just these filters, but this is kind of out of the bag. You can use this directly. And of course, if you're familiar with that algorithm, it's not guaranteed to converge. So you might be playing around with things, and they can you can try to specify a bandwidth that doesn't make sense for the convergence of the algorithm, and GNU Radio will throw an exception and warn you that that's what's happening. But you have to be aware of that. But of course, if you're using that algorithm, you have to be aware of it anyways. And here's just an example. And again, I put this up here because there's a little I keep forgetting to fix that. It should be freak 1 and freak 2, okay? With the FIRDES, and this has to be historic, and I don't know why, and I don't know whose fault it is to even blame, but the FIRDES, you specify the end of the pass band and the size of the transition band. This one, you specify the end of the pass band and the start of the transition band, the start of the stop band. So freak 2, if you can imagine in your heads that says freak 2, so freak 2 minus freak 1 is the transition band that we specified in the other one. But for some reason, whoever implemented these implemented with two different APIs. And that can be confusing, and I apologize for it. It's one of those things that you have to be aware of. So that does it for that aspect of the presentation. For kind of giving you the background of the filters, again, all of this will be made available so that you have these slides to look back to. What I want to maybe play with here is to go back into GRC, and I'm going to go back to my first experiment here, where I just had this noise source and I had this filter. So if you hadn't caught up, or if you're just doing it, you know, this is fairly simple. In fact, let's go ahead and just get rid of that null sync. Let's just look at it in this particular way. So we're doing noise source into the throttle to get our rate limiting, our FFT filter, and then our QT GUI sync here. What I specified before, what we haven't done anything yet with in GNU Radio is rate changing. And so the FFT filter or the FIR filter, those types of filters, are also decimating filters. So you can specify, or downsampling filters. So you can specify, as I said here, that this is where the language gets, you can specify a change in the sampling rate into and out of this filter. So we're going to decimate by a factor of 4. And of course, if we're being really good, what we should do is tell the QT GUI that its sample rate should expect a sample rate over 4. In reality, that doesn't matter a whole lot. What that's really going to do is just give us the right x-axis. You know, it doesn't really change anything except visualization, so that we know that we're operating on the right x-axis. But that's it. And then if I run this guy, you know, it's hard to see, but you know, we've now downsampled our signal versus what we did before. With noise, it's like I said, you don't really see it that much, but I think you all know what it means to downsample a signal. You can see, well, there's some structure, but that's mostly from the filtering. We'll see this in a lot more detail as I kind of walk through a lot of the MPSK examples, if we get in, how much we get into to doing that. See, I feel like that's a little bit longer than a second update, but anyways. So you can play with this this concept. Again, rate changes. If you wanted to do an interpolation, there is actually, where is he? Interpolating FIR filter. So over here, there's a FIR filter specifically that takes an interpolating factor as opposed to a decimation factor. So that's how you can use it to interpolate. Again, this polyphase arbitrary resampler, I think this one still requires us to specify the taps. The new one shouldn't. The new one, there's a wrapper that I created around this arbitrary resampler that instead of having to specify the taps, you just give it a resampling rate, and it automatically generates a half-band filter for us so that it's passing just the right information, but not no more, no less. But what this is, like I said, you know, you could specify some arbitrary, that's not gonna work, some arbitrary number in there, and it would actually resample to that new rate. It's pretty clever, and it's pretty good as far as suppressing any of the images. It's expensive. You know, there's no way around that, but it does do exactly what you want it to do. What other good ones here? And this is a nicety of the GNU Radio Companion. So under the filters, you'll see low pass, high pass, band reject, root race cosine. All of those things are wrappers around that FIRDES tool that we have to help us out, so that you don't necessarily always have to remember how to set your taps yourself. If you really just wanted a low pass filter, you can drag this out here And then when you double click on the properties, again, it's a decimating filter, so you can make use of that. And then here's all of those things that we specified in FERDES, now kind of made more obvious for us. So this is a nice kind of helper thing that GRC provides. I think this one actually just implements the FER. I don't think it does the FFT version of the FER. I can't be certain, which is kind of why I always do it myself, just so I know exactly what block I'm running. But just to get something up and running, this is a real convenient block. So as I said, for low pass, high pass, specifying all the parameters. So I'm gonna useful one for doing digital modulation is to be able to pulse shape your filter with a root raised cosine. You know, it's a pretty common pulse shaping filter. And here you can easily specify the various components to it. As opposed to specifying a bandwidth and a transition band, you specify the roll off factor alpha and even the number of taps that you actually wanna do to represent.
I noticed that the default is complex to complex. Mm-hmm. You're in your graph for the overlap save versus linear convolution. When everything is complex, it occurs at an even lower place.
Yes.
Yes, because there are six operations for every complex tap.
Right.
So it occurs even lower. So we really ought to make it default. That's just my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree, because even when we go back to that plot, when we go back to that plot, even if you're losing out down in those very small ones, you're not losing out by that much. I mean, that's a pathetic amount of time, unless you're really, really concerned about squeaking out every amount of extra computation. So I tend to default use FFT no matter what I'm doing, and yeah, you're right, the complex, even though, yeah. Even though we have spent a lot of time optimizing the FER filters. So if you're familiar with, let's see what time. So I've got about 10 minutes before our next break, I think, something like that. So I'll go into this, and then when we come back, I'll kind of show you some of the more advanced stuff that like their digital modulation stuff, which might be harder for you guys to necessarily kind of just pick up and run with, but we'll do what we can. What I wanted to say is, if you're familiar with processor architectures, there's kind of been this increasing evolution in their capabilities. What happened was in, I think it was 96, Intel released the first MMX processor. So if you're familiar with, like, you know, you'll see these little tags, you know, Intel processor with MMX, that was the multimedia extensions. They then increased it to SSE, so you might see, you know, powered by Intel with SSE logo or SSE2 or SE4, or what, you know, there's various versions of these. They're now selling things with AVX, and AVX2 I think should be out shortly. If you're familiar with the AMD brands, AMD used to have this 3D Now. So again, it's a little kind of marketing thing that you'd see 3D Now with an exclamation point. PowerPC has a thing called AltaVec, and even the ARM processors, which are, you know, huge now. I forget what I just heard, 70 billion ARM devices or something, like ridiculous number of processors. They now have a thing called the Neon extensions. And what all of these things are, they're like versions and variations of what's known as SIMD, which is single instruction, multiple data. So what you do is you actually have large vector or large registers inside of your computer. So SSE, you'd have 128-bit register as opposed to like a standard 32 or now 64-bit. So in a 128-bit register, you can now fit, say, four floating point numbers at once. And when you multiply those two registers, you're now multiplying four floats with one instruction. So that's what the single instruction multiple data. So with one instruction, you can perform operations on multiple data sets. They're kind of, in a way, like kind of DSP accelerators inside of processors. And as the name MMX multimedia extension indicates, they were originally designed to do graphics processing. So this is kind of before GPUs became a huge thing, the huge thing that they are now. So you wanted to be able to do kind of multiple operations on video streams. But of course, that translates very well into signal processing and wireless communications processing. So we've taken that as saying, look, we need to have access to these things. They speed up tremendously our capabilities in doing processing and general purpose processors. The problem with it is, as I just explained, MMX, SSE, SSE2, 3D Now, if you look at them, you're still basically kind of, you're almost doing assembly level programming, even when you're using the C or C++ library that Intel provides you, like the SSE intrinsics, they're called. It's still very, very difficult, and I'm sure Phil Karn back there can attest to this if you ever try to look at any of his code. It's really powerful, but really hard to use and get right, and be portable. So you want to be portable. GNU Radio operates on all sorts of processors, Intel's, AMD's, PowerPC's, ARM's, and we want access to all of these in as general and generic way as possible. So the filters were highly optimized originally by Eric, by hand, in this very, very clever, very, very useful abstraction, but not very changeable, not very extensible. So we recently introduced a project called Volk, which is the Vector Optimized Library of Kernels. This was kind of built for GNU Radio and then donated to us as a project. And this does this abstraction for us. It's a very nice abstract way of accessing these really highly powerful registers and operations within general purpose processors. But it's done in such a way that there's always a generic fallback so that if your processor doesn't support AVX2, and that's the only special operation that you've written for it, there's always a generic C block that it falls back on. So it's designed in such a way to help you when it can. This is what Bob was talking about earlier. It helps you when it can, but it always has a fallback that that's just straight up C, so that every processor can still use a Volk function. Really powerful, has really dramatically improved the efficiency of GNU Radio. And we've only just hit the very beginnings of using Volk inside GNU Radio. Our multiplication operators, our adders, the filters are probably the most complicated that use Volk, but there's a huge amount of efficiency to be gained with this. I told Steve how to do this. We don't need to go through the exercise, but there's a profiler essentially for your computer. So Volk wants, it has a whole bunch of implementations of these highly specialized kernels of math, and it wants to find the one that's right for your computer. Because it's not an obvious mapping. Just because my computer supports SSE4, which is supposed to have some support for complex numbers, doesn't guarantee that the SSE4 is actually the fastest way to do complex multiplication. Now that could be our fault for not coding that kernel properly, but you want to know that. And so Volk has a profiler that goes through and says, what is the best thing that your machine is capable of doing for this particular mathematical operation? And that then goes into GNU Radio and helps make sure that your system is performing at the best kernel of math that we can provide for it. Hugely, hugely powerful library. We think it's much bigger than GNU Radio. The idea is hopefully we'll actually extract it from GNU Radio and release it as its own separate library so that people can use this easily in their code. But it explodes the possibilities for doing this highly specialized vectorized operations simply in code. And so we've re-architected GNU Radio for it, and it has been a tremendous, tremendous help. There's one, so if you do the Volk profiling, there's one where it's just doing a rotator. So it's just taking, complex number rotation, so phase rotation of a complex number. The generic version for doing however many samples on my machine comes in at 5.5 seconds. The AVX-enabled version comes in at under 0.5 seconds. So a massive, massive improvement in speed that if we don't take advantage of in GNU Radio, we're really missing out. And so that's been just in the past year or two that we've really been kind of up to speed with it. So that's a little under the hood stuff, but as I said, I think it's important that's known, because when you're dealing with software radio, as you can see here, we're dealing with operating systems, we're dealing with computer science, we're dealing with digital signal processing, and then if we had hardware hooked up, we'd have to worry about the real radio issues as well. All of these things have to at least be appreciated, if not fully understood, by someone who's doing software radio. You know, it's a multidisciplinary world that you have to have some familiarity and at least, like I said, appreciation for the existence of these things. And so worrying about things like how to use Volk to make our system more efficient and process faster, those are key elements to thinking, you know, within the software radio mindset. So I'm going to take another a few minutes break. Are we good to do that? And then we've got just under an hour left. So we're just going to start playing around with some more complex signals when we get back in about 5 minutes.